the sword of the Spirit, which is the rhema of God. His Greek word is rhema. Now we'll explain how this ties together in a minute. But his Greek word is rhema. Now rhema means utterance, or words spoken or declared. It is the declaration of the Logos that you got from the Graphe. The Graphe is the book. The Logos is the message. The rhema is the utterance, the speech, the spokenness of the message. You could be the owner of a Bible factory and not have a sword. So you can make Bibles and not have a sword. He says the sword that the Spirit uses is the rhema of God. Here it is. The Graphe, the book, gives you the Logos, the message. But it is the rhema that plunges in and draws blood. It is the rhema that the Spirit uses. So many of us are not seeing the power of the Spirit because we haven't graduated to the rhema. We're either stuck at Graphe because we bought a Bible at church. You know, that folk will bring the Bible to church, don't even know how to open it. And tell them don't bring the Bible to church. You are stuck at the Graphe because it's just a book and you feel holier because you walk with it. But the Spirit doesn't use that. That's not the tool for the spiritual warfare. It's still the Word of God, but it's not the tool that the Spirit uses. Others of us, perhaps most of us, we come to understand the Logos, the message. We want to understand the sermon. We want to understand the truth. We want to understand its message. We may be inspired by it. We're educated by it, oriented by it. And so we now understand something we did not previously understand from the Graphe that now has become Logos in our minds and understanding. But when it comes to spiritual warfare, when the enemy is all up in your grill, you need more than Graphe and Logos. You need Rhema. You need the Logos from the Graphe uttered, spoken, or declared. Why do you want to Rhema the Logos? Well, you have to understand this for fully get this. Why do you want a rhema, utter, declare, speak? The Logos, the message. Because of the intrinsic nature of the Logos. Turn to Hebrews 4. Hebrews chapter 4. We'll come back to rhema in a minute, but I want you to understand it because what you are doing the rhema on is the Logos. To get the Logos, you bring the Graphe. So I go to the Graphe, the writings, to get the message. But I don't get the message to say I enjoy church. I get the message so when I need rhema. In Hebrews chapter 4, he speaks about the Logos. And this is what he says, beginning in verse 12. For the word Logos of God is living. When you get the message, not when you carry the book, but when you get the message, that is a living message. It is not just information, it is alive. The Logos of God is alive and it is active. It is not only alive, it has energy behind it. You know, it's got a force field. He says the Logos of God is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword. Watch this now. He says the Logos of God is sharper than a sword whose blades on both sides have been sharpened. In other words, it can cut you either way. You can go this way and it'll cut you. You can go that way and it'll cut you because on both sides it's sharp. Now, you got to follow me here. He says, the Logos of God
you said, but wait a minute, you just said it a minute ago that the sword of the spirit is the rhema. Yes, the sword of the spirit is the rhema when he's going to use it. But I'm trying to tell you what he uses when he uses it. He uses it when it's rhema. It's alive when it's logos. So by the time it hits rhema, if you got logos, you got a sword with life in it. Because he says the logos of God is alive and active and sharper than any two-edged sword, and is piercing as far as the division of soul and spirit. Now, why do you need to know that the logos of God can get down to spirit and soul? Because your spirit and soul is your invisible world. That's the invisible world. Your visible world is the physical, your body. Your invisible world, the world where you truly live, is made up of soul, your personality, and it's made up of spirit, the God presence in you. He says this thing is so sharp that it can slice the invisible realm, separating spirit and soul. Now, why does God want to use the logos, the message, to separate your spirit from your soul? Because your soul gets in the way of the spirit. Your personality, how you were raised, your orientation, your thought, your perspective keeps getting in God's way. So God's got to slice you out of the way so his spirit can break through. See, we have so intertwined our souls with God's spirit that we keep getting in God's way. So God wants the logos to get you out the way. And he wants to get you out the way. And he says the only thing that can do that is the message of God. So when you come and you hear the message, you hear the content of the word, and it dawns on you that what you thought and what God says isn't the same, you just got sliced and diced. When you come and you hear the word of God and you discover that your perspective, what mama taught you, what daddy taught you, disagrees with what God says, and it dawns on you, you had all this stuff mixed up and you had God's name all up in your soul. When God, it had nothing to do with how you were thinking and how you were functioning and how you were operating, you got sliced and diced. He said it is active. It is sharper than any two-edged sword. It can divide. It is piercing. It is penetrating down to the invisible level of joints and marrow. And it is able to discern, judge. It is able to discern the thoughts and intents of the heart. See, here's the problem with the word, with the logos. The problem with the logos is it not only attacks what you do, it attacks what you think. He says it gets down to what you were thinking. It gets down to the thoughts, and it goes deeper than the thought. It goes to the intent. Not only what you were thinking, but what you were thinking about what you were thinking. It gets down to the thoughts and intents of the heart. It is penetrating. Why is it penetrating? Verse 13. There is no creature hidden from his sight. I thought you were talking about the logos. Yeah, but he told you the logos is alive. So if the logos is alive, where does the life come from? His sight. Because God stands behind his word. So whatever his word sees is because God is seeing it. So it says, there is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are open and laid bare to the eyes of him with whom we have to do. In other words, you've been sliced open. Let's put it another way. The word of God's goal, logos, is to expose. It is to expose. It is God's MRI machine. It is God's X-ray machine. If all you get when you come to church is what you hear in your external ear, all you did was open up Graphe. You opened up Graphe and somebody told you something. When the truth hits you, you ran into logos. You ran into logos because the message is given. Jesus is called the the Logos in John 1 because he was God's messenger. He came to present God to human beings. He was the deliverer of the message. He says that the word of God, the Logos, penetrates with power. When the message is given, when you grab the message and accept it, you now have understanding. You say, oh, that's what that says and that's what that means. Then what happens? He says, the sword of the Spirit, which is the rhema of God. Now he brings in rhema. Rhema is the word of God uttered or used. Graphe is the writings. It's just been written. Logos is the message of what's been written. Rhema is the use of the message. When you pull out rhema, you just pulled out the Spirit. Because the sword is the sword of the Spirit. When you pull out rhema, that is when the word that you have becomes the message that you deliver in short battle conflict when it's all up in your face. You have now given something the Spirit uses. If you are satisfied with graphe, just having a Bible in your car, you know, on your kitchen table, in your bookshelf, or under your arm, that's not going to help you in close up front battle. If you only have Logos coming to church, hearing the sermon, even understanding the message, that message is true, that message is alive, that message is active, that message works in the spiritual realm, but in close up battle, when hell breaks through in your life, the evil day, says what the Spirit wants you to use now is not just the understanding tape you've been listening to or radio broadcast you've been listening to. It now has to do with a sword you use, a dagger you use, and he calls that the rhema of God, the utterance of God. In the beginning, God said, let there be light. God spoke. Bible says, and it was so. In other words, the spoken word had within it the power to do what the spoken word declared would be done. God spoke it, and what he said happened. And it happened exactly like he spoke it, but watch this, it didn't happen till he spoke it. God didn't just think, was light, because there was power in the word used, not just God even having the word known. God knows it all, but he used what he knew.
You say it's a war.
The spoken word had power in it to produce what the spoken word called for. It was a dagger used. That is, it was what the Spirit had. How do we know that the Spirit had something to do with it? Because it says that when God was ready to create, the Spirit of God was hovering over, ready to move when it heard the spoken word. The Spirit of God was just hovering over, just biding his time, saying to the Father, as soon as you talk, I'm ready to act. I'm hanging out. As soon as you say something, I'm going to do something. But I'm waiting on you, Father, because I can't do something till you say something. But when you say something, whatever you say, I'm going to do, because you have given me what I need to pull it off. When Adam and Eve fell in the garden, what did the devil do? Mess with that word. He said, well, hath God said, let's talk about what God said. Because he knew if he could mess up the use of the word, he would mess up their power. And he could now take control, because he now